In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. Welcome to Living Word Baptist Church, where the Word of God comes alive. Our mission is to exalt the Savior, equip the saint, evangelize the sinner, and empower the community. Our pastor and first lady are Reginald and Vanessa Fletcher. Please enjoy this recording of a portion of one of our Sunday morning services, and stay tuned at the end for general information about our exciting ministry and how you can get involved. Now, let's enter in and be blessed.
This morning, I need for everybody to stand on your feet if you're able. And I want you to get in groups of three. Somebody preferably that you don't know, that's not in your immediate family. And we're going to pray this morning. And we're all going to pray out loud. So I need for you to move around. Amen. Amen. Move around. Move around. Move around. Move around.
You ain't in my family.
Amen. Amen. Listen. On yesterday morning, Pastor Barber, you know, he was here for our anniversary. His brother had passed of pancreatic cancer. They buried him on yesterday morning. This morning I got a phone call Brenda Thomas' sister was rushed to the hospital on this morning. We went to pray with her and the family on this morning. And we just want to share with us that you don't know in the hour or the hour that God might call your name.
Right.
He may not call you unto death, but sickness, struggle, challenge is always there. Thing that we need to be mindful of is that we don't want to wait until we need prayer in order to pray. And we ought to be praying, you know, as the old folks used to say, coming up and say, well, I'm sending up timber.
Uh-huh.
And we got to learn how to send up timber. So I want all of us across this building and all of us with whose hands you now hold, don't be ashamed to call on the Lord. If you don't know what to say, just talk to him like you're talking to your homie.
Yes. Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Talk to him like you're talking to your boo. Yes. But tell him the truth.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. Listen, we need to be real, because one of the things that we're finding today is that too many of us are worshiping in a show.
Uh-huh.
It's not about where we are in God, but it's about the road we're on and whether or not that road is faced towards him or away from him. And the only way that that road is clear is when we open up our hearts. And so we would ask if you would just simply pray aloud with the people whose hands you now hold, and we'll carry on from here. Amen. Oh God, we come to you. As humble as we know how, oh God, we thank you for these sisters whose hands I now hold. I pray, oh God, that you would meet them at the point of their needs and in the hour that they need you, and even in the way that they need you. Touch them from the crown of their heads to the very soles of their feet. Lift up their hearts. If there's anything that looks like sin, I pray now that you would move it as far as the east is from the west. But more importantly, oh God, I pray now for their spiritual health. Pray, God, that you would move in them, that you would strengthen them, you would strengthen their families, that their families might not be able to see them the same as they came this morning, but they might be able to see you. Seek your face to become the men and women of God, to challenge and proclaim a living gospel, that we might not just simply hear, but we might live what we read and also what we hear. Let us do what you have placed in our hearts to do, and also lead us and guide us. Teach us, O God, that we might be able to walk in your way with also with assurance that you have promised never to leave us nor forsake us. Now, O God, we pray for this worship experience. I pray, O God, that we might be moved by your presence, that we might be touched by your spirit, that we might be kissed by your holy love, that we might share with others and also receive from thee the awesomeness of living these last days. Now, oh God, I pray for our leaders of this country, of this state, of this city. I pray, oh God, that you would touch them with your finger of love and understanding. But also, Father God, I pray that you would touch them with your finger of rebuke and discipline. And when we leave from you, dear gracious Father, and we abuse your people, we pray now that you would move like you've never moved before. Now, oh God, we pray for the judges that we sit up under. We pray now challenges that we are faced with even on today. Oh God, today as we stand behind this sacred desk to declare your sacred and precious word, I pray, God, that you would move within me. Move me from me that I might glorify thee and empower these thy people with a word from on high. Empower them to know that with you all things are possible. With you, we can do all things. We are more conquerors because you loved us. You loved us so much that you gave your life for us. Now, God, we pray that we'll be able to live for thee, not just in these four walls, but as we leave from this place. We pray, oh God, that you would go before us. Give us direction. You know all about our struggles. You know all about our trials. We ask that you would let us understand you are God. Might seek your face. We'll be careful. Give you the praise, glory, and the honor. And we give you this prayer in Jesus' name. Thank God afresh for what he has done, what he is doing. Understand that what you're going through right now, you're not alone. And what God is saying to you, look to the hills from which cometh your help. Help doesn't come from a person sitting next to you. Help doesn't come from your mama or your daddy. Help doesn't come from pastor from this sacred desk. But it comes from your personal walk with the Master. It's something to say that you know him. But it's another thing to walk in the revelation of knowing him. Yeah. See, to know him, you could be familiar, or you heard something about him. But when you are knowing him, it denotes a personal relationship. It is an ongoing process. So many times we know about God, and that's what causes gaps in our prayer life. We know God when we are struggling. We know God when we are in trouble. But when things are on the right track, we don't realize that they're really on the wrong track. But we claim the right track because we don't see the trouble. But I stopped by to share with you. And if you would just walk with me and pray with me this morning, I don't intend to be long, but I do intend to be obedient. The scripture teaches us from Nehemiah 1. You don't have to stand for the reading. I'm just going to read chapter 1 for us on today from the Holman Christian Standard Version. And I want to talk about a made-up mind to pray. You can't pray unless your mind is made up to pray. And the only way your mind is made up to pray is that you acknowledge what and how God is taking you through a thing. Even the atheist who says that there is no God, at a particular point or pressure in his or her life, will call on the name of the Lord. Yeah, but the problem is, they still believe that what they do in their own might. Yeah. Nehemiah was in captivity. He was given favor of God. And he was elevated to a place of position and power. And even though he had position and power, he was still a slave. And the significance is, what gave him favor was the fact that he never forgot the God who delivered him. Here's a man in a servant's situation, and yet he is still lifting and praising God. Listen to his prayer in the first chapter of the book of Nehemiah. The words of Nehemiah's son, Hilkiah, during the month of Cheslu, in the 20th year, when I was in the fortress city of Susa, Hananiah, one of my brothers, arrived with men from Judah, and I questioned them about Jerusalem and the Jewish remnant that had returned from exile. They said to me, the survivors in the Providence who returned from the exile are in great trouble and disgrace. Jerusalem's walls has been broken down and its gates have been burned down. When I heard these words, I sat down and wept. I mourned a number of days, fasting and praying before the God of heaven. I said, Lord God of heaven, the great, awe-inspiring God who keeps his gracious covenant with those who love him and keep his commands, let your eyes be open and your ears be attentive to hear your servant's prayer, that I might now pray to you day and night. For your servants, the Israelites, I confess the sins we have committed against you. Both I and my father's house have sinned. We have acted corruptly towards you and have not kept the commands, statutes, and ordinances you gave your servant Moses. Please remember what you commanded your servant Moses. If you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the peoples. But if you return to me and carefully observe my commands, even though your exiles were banished to the ends of the earth, I will gather them from there and bring them to the place where I chose to have my name dwell.
Yes, God.
They are your servants, your people.
Yes.
You redeemed them by your great power and strong hand. Please, Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and go to that of your servants who delight and revere your name. Give your servant success today and have compassion on him in the presence of this man.
Yes, God.
At the time, I was the king's cupbearer.
Uh-huh.
Nehemiah has begun to pray. The significance in this passage of scripture is as you listen to his oration and his dialect or dialogue with God, you can tell there is something significant in his conversation with the Lord. You can tell that he is no novice when it comes to spending time with the Lord. You can tell that he is a full-time employee and not a part-time employee. You can tell that he has benefits along with his employment.
All right.
He has some extra bonus because of his struggle with being a child of God. You can tell that he has went to bed some nights and cried his way to sleep, and the Spirit of God crept in to his dreams and touched him with a finger of love and told him to keep on fighting. Keep on holding on. No matter what it seems like on the outside, I'm with you. I'm holding you up when nobody else will hold you up. And I'm covering you in the midst of whatever struggle might be. There are three things that we hear from Nehemiah in this first chapter. We hear his passion for prayer, his passion for God. We see the pity with which he prays. We see the priority of God in his prayers. Listen to the close of his prayer. As he wraps up the prayer, he's saying to God, just lend your ear to this servant, and I need for you to prepare the man whom I have to ask for provisions to go and do the task that you have called me to do. Nehemiah didn't have any money. Nehemiah didn't have any wealth. And so he knew he needed some supplies to go back home and rebuild not only the walls of the people of Jerusalem, but also the dignity and the worth of the people whom he had talked about. You know, the thing that we need to be mindful of is that a lot of times we see on the faces of our folk, our family, our friends, our church members, we see the distortion in their face. They come in twisted because of the pressures of life. And instead of us having passion and compassion, we want to make light of their situation.
My God.
Or we want to put them on Front Street. Or we are insensitive to to what's going on, and we say something that is truly out of the character of God. We're trying to be humble in what we're saying, but the challenge for us is that we need to be passionate about one another. Today in life, we don't care about one another. It's difficult for us to talk to one another in a way that can relate and connect with one another. We spend more time with our face in our phone than we do with our face to face with people we're talking to. We don't confront folk with what's going on with them. We try to dance around the issue rather than approach the fact that there is a struggle in our relationship. Why is that? Is it because we have no passion for the people whom God has invited into our relationship? People that you come in contact with, it's not something that you have chosen. God has chosen them for you. It's up to us to regulate in our hearts, in our mind, to ask the question, why did God put you in my life?
Yes, God. Come on now.
He didn't put you in my life just so that I could manipulate you. He didn't place you in my life so that I could use you. But he put you in my life that I might learn from you. I got to learn how to give. Not of my substance, but of myself. Most of us will give things, but we won't give of ourselves. Life is too full of busyness. And so we can't afford to give of ourselves. Why? Because we have this mask that we wear.
Wow.
We have this box that we live in. We have these preconceived notions as to what you are supposed to do for me. And yet, I'm not willing to do anything for you.
Help us.
And it could be the flip side. We could get so full of ourselves about what we have done. And all that we have done has been from our substance, but not from our heart.
Come on now.
God doesn't want anything of your substance. He says, the psalmist writes, the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof belongs to God. And the thing that's so awesome about the God that we serve, we belong to him as well. But he does not lord over us against our will.
Thank you, Lord.
He could have touched you this morning and made you come to worship. He could have snatched your choice away from you and placed you in the sanctuary and commanded you to worship him.
Jesus.
But that would go against his own character and the attributes of an all-seeing and loving God.
Yes, God.
He has passion for each and every one of us. It's not about what we owe him. It's about what we offer him. The question is, why is it that we only wait till Sunday to pay him?
Watch out, Pastor.
All right.
What we owe him.
All right.
Jesus.
It could be because we haven't learned how to offer him what he is looking for. We've been hanging around our homies too long, and they have put more emphasis on what we got on than what we got in. And I called Kevin out this morning. When I came down this morning, I was dressed to do some snow pushing. And then when I came and changed, Kevin said, you look pretty good now. You look pretty good.
All right.
Now. But I was the same person this morning.
Come on, Pastor. Yes.
In my blue jeans and my steel-toe boots.
Yeah.
As I is.
Right now.
Right now.
Yes, God.
And we tend to focus
on
the outside.
Yes.
But when there is passion, it connects heart to heart.
Thank you, Lord.
Passion pulls out of us that which God has deposited in us. It's not about what I can do for you.
Right.
It's about what God is doing in both of us.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
When I pray
unto
God with everything that I is, God hears and answers my prayer.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
He may not answer it the way I want him to answer it. Answers my prayer.
Yes.
But the only way I can realize that he has answered my prayer is that my passion has to be connected to him.
Thank you.
I've got to see with faith eyes, not fact eyes.
Yes, God. Thank you.
My faith projects the facts.
Jesus.
My faith ignites the facts.
Yes, God.
My faith initiates, it starts the facts.
All right.
What are the facts, preacher? Well, I'm glad you asked.
All right.
The facts are that My God loved me enough that he sent not a committee, but he sent his son.
Thank God.
Came down through 40, I'm almost through, 42 generations. Loved me enough that he gave up
for your passion.
His glory
in
heaven.
Thank you, God.
Gave his lightning, his eyes, his flashing eyes to the lightning. Gave his melodious voice to the thunder. And yet he took Joseph's coat of many colors. Made a promise that he would not destroy the world with water. Flung a rainbow in the sky. The thing that you need to understand that even in a snowstorm, you can see a rainbow. But sometimes we need to understand what it means to be passionate about our relationship with God.
Thank you, Lord.
I don't have to wait till trouble comes. I just get up in the morning with an urge. I got an itch that can't nobody get but God. I got to call on his name. My feet go to aching. And I can't keep still. I got a passion for the master. Going through struggle over and over and over. I seem like I can't get on the right track. But when I'm still, I hear a quiet, soft voice that tells me to stand.
Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank
passion.
Thank you, Jesus.
When you are passionate about what you live, it is defined by what you do.
That's right.
Most of us take life for granted. A lot of us have just accepted life as that's the hand that it dealt me. But I stopped by to share with you on my way to Heaven Gates, if there's passion in you, it tells you that God has declared within each and every one of us.
All right.
That I can do all things.
Yes.
Through Christ.
Yes.
That strengthens me.
Praise
how Nehemiah began to pray. He didn't pray from his own perspective. But he started praying through Christ. How do you know that, preacher? Well, listen to the word he used. He used the Deuteronomic promise that God had given to Moses. And he then began to use the love of God.
All right.
Listen to what he said. These are your people.
Yes.
Lord Jesus.
Whom you have created. And the reason you created them was because of your love for them.
Yes, God. Thank you, Lord.
The thing that you hear in the text, he says, listen, God knows that we're not perfect. He said, you are going to stray away and you're going to be disobedient.
Yes, we are.
And I'm going to discipline you. But if you would
come on now
to yourself,
All right.
If you would understand the distance that you have set between you and I, I'll bring you back. It's right there in the word. It's in the prayer. You see, most of us have done our dirt, and we are too ashamed to to come to God.
Come on, Pastor.
And admit that we ain't all that we claim to be.
That's right, that's right.
And so we have resigned to the fact that God has made me a second-class citizen. When you make up in your mind that you're second class, passion seeps out of your prayer.
Right, 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 right.
You start just going through the motions of praying because it's your duty to pray. You begin to have pity. You pray out of pity. You're not coming before the throne of God boldly, you are creeping around the throne of God. You know he's seeing your dirt. Instead of coming in the front door, you slide in the back. You found yourself struggling with life.
Help us, God. Help
pity us. Has invited you to a party. And you've taken your invitation and proudly came to the door. Can I walk through some pitiful prayers?
Watch out, watch out, watch out.
A pitiful prayer is when you're at the last of the last. You at the end of your rope.
Wow.
You flying high yesterday. But today, the man comes. Says, I'm going to take back your automobile. Yeah. You immediately go in praying.
Not my car, Lord.
Nah. I ain't going to do that. You come,
Jesus,
and your bills are due.
Well, yes.
And you have been big enough, bad enough, and black enough to go out and buy you a new outfit, knowing that your bills are due. And you have the nerve to say, I'm too blessed to be stressed. And you steadily calling on the name of the Lord and living any kind of way. That's a pitiful prayer. Here's the kicker. You expect God to come to your rescue in spite of what you are sharing with him. And you know what? Even in your pitiful walk, God shows up. But a pitiful prayer doesn't bring about change or transformation. A pitiful prayer only brings to the surface sorrow of heart. There's a difference between being sorry and repenting for the wrong that I've done. Most of us pray pitiful prayers because we are praying that God would get us out of this mess. And soon as he gets us out of this mess, we open the door back to the mess. Because the prayer ought not be, get me out. The prayer ought to be, empower me to go through. Teach me, oh God, to lean on your precepts and your commands. Teach me, oh God, how to fight the
good fight of faith. Teach me, oh God, how to run my course with faith. Teach me.
But a pitiful prayer is all about what I want.
Yes.
Not about what I need.
Yes.
And when we look at this thing.
Come on now.
Yes, no. Yes, no.
I'm going to sit down now. I ain't through, but I'm going to sit down.
All right. All right. All right.
We need to understand why our prayers are pitiful. And when we look at that word pitiful, that means it's full of pity.
Yes, yes.
We some sorry believers. We some shiftless believers. Because we have given God the leftovers. Some of you read your Bibles in the book of Malachi. They began to bring an offering. They bought 10%.
Right.
They bought a tithe, but it was 10% of the leftover.
Come on, Pastor.
It was a pitiful offering that they brought unto God.
My Lord, my Lord.
So much so, and so pitiful was the offering.
Come on now.
Malachi asked the question, will a man rob God? You see, they thought they were doing something because they had brought an offering. But it wasn't, as in Proverbs 3, the first fruits of the harvest. It was the leftovers.
All right, all right.
Now, let me ask you a question. Are you bringing the Lord your leftovers? Because if you are bringing leftovers, you're also sending up pitiful prayers. And I'm going to drop this on you, then I'm going to sit down. First, we need to understand that our prayers must be passionate.
All right, all right.
Yes, yes, sir. Yes.
We need to be able to identify pitiful prayers.
Yes, yes, yes.
But the only way to identify pitiful prayers is that prayer itself must be a priority in your life.
Yes, yes, yes.
Scripture says to us in Thessalonians, it says, pray without ceasing.
Right.
Jesus said in Luke 18, he says, men ought to always pray. He says, when you have done all that you can, bring your petition before the Lord. Philippians says that we need to pray with thanksgiving. And in all things, we ought to pray.
Just pray. Pray.
Paul said it in Ephesians. He says to us, we ought to stand and do all that it is that we can do to stand. And when you've done all that you can, stand some more. What does it mean to be, have God in priority? It means that when I wake up in the morning, first somebody I talk to is the Lord. When I lay down at night, the last somebody I talk to is the Lord. When I'm about to make a decision, I talk to the Lord. When I'm headed on my job, what direction do I take? Geographically, I know down the road that I'm going. But what can I expect for God to lead me and how to lead me on this day? am I looking for an opportunity to share the awesomeness of what God means to me?
All right now. Yeah.
Or am I shy and shamed to be called a child of the Most High?
All right, all right, all right.
That's the issue that we have today.
Yes, yes, Lord. Yes.
In the book of Psalms, the 11th chapter, David makes this declaration and asks this question. If the foundations be destroyed, what will the righteous do? Righteousness has nothing to do with how you walk. Righteousness has everything to do with why you walk.
All right.
The way you walk. Can I say that again? Righteousness has nothing to do with how you walk. It has everything to do with why you walk, the way you walk. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he has done for me, I don't want to go back to being the sinner that I used to be. I'm still a sinner. But the sinner I used to be has no control over me. Because I'm walking like Patti LaBelle with a new attitude. I got my mind made up that I'm going to serve the Lord. In spite of what I'm going through. In spite of how they treat me. In spite of what they do to me. I'm going to serve the Lord. And I'm going to bless God.
Yes.
Why? Because he's priority.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Can I drop something on you?
Go ahead and drop it.
And then I'm through. You know why I got to make God priority?
Why is that?
Because he made me priority first. I didn't have to find him. He found me. When I was running from him, he seemed to turn up everywhere I turned.
Yes, God.
I went in places where I thought he wouldn't come, but he was right there. I did things that I knew he was displeased with, but he still was right there. And because he made me his priority, when I stopped running, I'd make him my priority. No matter what you're going through, no matter how you're going through it, you've got to learn to pray with passion. You've got to understand how to stay out of pitiful prayers. You got to prioritize God in the forefront of everything that you is.
Yes, God.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Songwriter said it like this. I've had, you want to do this? Some good days.
Hallelujah.
I've had some hills to climb.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
I've had some weary days. I've had. I don't know the rest of it. But he knows what's best for me. The doors of church are open. Listen.
Thank you, Lord.
You got to make up in your mind.
Yes. In the name of Jesus.
The prayer is going to be priority.
Yes.
It's not just something that you do, but it is what you is.
All right.
You see, you've got to live what you believe in order for it to be real.
Yes, yes, Mom.
Trust in Him. Because when you've done all that you can do,
yes,
you got to stand on Him.
Jesus.
Why would I stand on Jesus? Angie, you ask such good questions. I stand on Jesus because He stood in the midst of nothing. Called a world into existence. Gave me something to stand on.
All right.
I might be struggling with myself. I might be afraid of myself. I might be ashamed of myself. But He's not afraid of me. He's not ashamed of me. He had enough passion in spite of me turning my back on Him. In spite of me giving up on Him.
All right.
He still loved me enough to call my name. He loved me enough to remember me. He loved me enough that when nobody else would care, He cared. Don't you want a God like that? Thing is so awesome is that mama can love you almost like that. One of those days, mama won't be here. Your daddy might love you, but one of these days, daddy's gonna leave you. But the scripture says, when father and mother have forsaken you, I will stoop and scoop, take you unto my own self. Because I'm passionate about who you are. I see no pity in what you are. And you are priority to God.
Thank you.
It begins with a prayer. Will you pray with me?
Yes.
Oh God.
Thank you, Lord.
I know I have not been all that you have expected of me or from me. And I know that going forward I'm going to stumble. But I surrender unto you, oh God. I pray that you would make a way out of no way. I present unto you all of us in this place.
Yes.
That you might do with us what you will.
Yes.
I pray, oh God, that you would strengthen us in your might. I pray, oh God, that you would teach us how to be passionate. How to be more loving. How to be more committed. I pray, oh God, that you would uncover our pitiful situations, that we might turn from them and turn to you. And finally, oh God, I pray that as you have made us your priority, I pray that we might make you ours. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 We thank God afresh for what he has done and all that he is doing. Listen, we have two more weeks here. We want to deal with Nehemiah chapter 2 on next Sunday. We want to talk about stewardship in February. In March, I want to start a verse-by-verse exposition of the book of Ephesians for the remainder of the year. So we want to walk through the book of Ephesians as our next series of studies. And I want you to walk with me, read and study with me.
Yeah, yeah.
So we'll understand what God is offering us, also what he's expecting from us. If we don't grab hold of our relationship with God now, David's questions of the foundations will be on us. And I don't know about you, but on my watch, I want the Lord to say when I get home, you've done all that you could to lift up the name of Jesus. And it starts in us personally. So we want to walk through, and we want to seriously look at what God is doing in us. You know, if the ministry or the word has blessed you, it's up to you to tell somebody.
All right, all right.
Not looking to build, have no house full.
Lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. Beloved, we are thankful, excited, and humbled that you decided to worship with us today. We pray this recording has been a blessing to you and that you are not the same person you were before you heard it. If you're interested in worshiping with us again, our normal Sunday morning service times begin with Sunday school for all ages starting at 9 a.m. And our Sunday morning worship and celebration begins at 10:15 a.m. We also have midweek Wednesday Bible study at two convenient times, either 12 noon or 6:30 p.m. For more information about our church and other ministries, please check out our website at www.lwbcindy.org. That's www.lwbcindy.org. Or friend us on Facebook or follow us on Twitter at LWBCINDY. Beloved, we just want you to know we love you. And remember, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. May God bless you and keep you.